All right, so
in the last day of notes, we talked about titrations, and we had two examples, and both of them actually involved a strong acid being titrated by a strong base, meaning we had in our container already a strong acid, and we kept adding a strong base. And we said for every mole of base that we add, it reacts and takes away or subtracts from the moles of our particular acid. And what's left over is going to determine the pH. Whether we have leftover strong acid or we have leftover strong base, we would find the concentration and go from here. Okay, or go from there, plug that into our pH formula. Now, check this out on this problem here. First off, it says it right in the title. Our acetic acid, CH3COOH, is what type of acid, strong or weak? It's weak, okay? So I want to set this up as such. And the other class asked a really good question. Okay, do I need to set this up? No, not necessarily, but it helps build a picture of what is exactly happening. Okay, so I like to write down our equation. And so it is weak here. So we have acetic acid, CH3COOH, and it's aqueous. It combines there with liquid water. And again, because it's weak, we're at equilibrium, and we would still get H3O with a 1 plus and our acetate ion. Okay, so we would have this set up. All right. Then the other thing that I want to start out with is, what do we have in the container right at the beginning? Well, right at the beginning, we have right here at the end, we have 50 milliliters of 0.1 molar acetic acid. Okay. 50 milliliters of 0.1 molar acetic acid. I'll ask you this. Did we really use molarity when we did titrations yesterday? No, we had to convert molarity initially to moles. So we're going to jump in and say that, right? We have 0.100 big M molar of our acetic acid. And we want to know, hey, how many moles of acid do we have? Weak acid specifically. And we divide it not by 50 milliliters, but what do we need to do to that 50?
0.005.
Yep, well, just 0.0, but we need it in liters. Yep, 0.050 liters. And we would cross multiply and you'd say, okay, 0.05 times 0.1. And again, just like we got yesterday here, we have 0.005 moles of our acetic acid. And I'm actually going to spell this out, our CH3COOH. Okay, if you want to be more specific, that is our acid. Okay, then just like we did yesterday, we looked and we said, okay, we're adding a strong base. We're adding 45 milliliters of 0.1 molar sodium hydroxide. Okay. 0.1 molar sodium hydroxide, not so much useful for us right now. We need moles. So we're going to say, okay, 0.100 molar of sodium hydroxide is going to give us some number of moles of our base, specifically our sodium hydroxide. So we would divide this, again, not by 45 milliliters. We would divide that by 1,000. So this is 0.045 big L for liters, and we would cross multiply. So we take 0.1 times 0.045, and we would get our number of 0.0045 moles. And we could be specific here. We could say sodium hydroxide, but more importantly, it is our base. Now, for each mole of base that we added, just like yesterday, what did we take away from as we add that mole of base?
Take away from the acid.
There it is. We take away, for every 1 mole of sodium hydroxide that we add, we take away that same exact amount from our original asset. Same steps remain as yesterday, but we have 0.0045 moles of our base added here. And so you could put base or sodium hydroxide. And so at the end of the day, if we take 0.005 and we subtract 0.0045, so we'd have 0.005 minus 0.0045, we would end up with 0.0005 moles of our acid, right? You could say it's acetic acid because it is, but more importantly, of our acid, all right? Now, we have a weak acid. There is a formula that we can use for a weak acid and its conjugate base.
EKA.
There we go. I like it. We can use the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation, which says this. I'm going to rewrite this. I'm going to say, hey, our pH of a buffer, weak acid and its conjugate base, is equal to the pKa plus the log of our base over our acid. Okay? Now, a couple of things that I want to point out. One, we added 0.0045 moles of sodium hydroxide, which results, or we could say that this is adding 0.0045 moles of our acetate ion. So in reality, when we add our sodium hydroxide, we are really having 0.0045 moles of, I'll call this conjugate base present. Conjugate base present. And this thing right here that I just wrote down in blue is going to go into that base portion of our Henderson-Hasselbalch equation. Now, the remaining acid, because the sodium hydroxide reacted with our acetic acid, the remaining acid is going to be the amount of acid that we have and the amount that we put into our particular formula. So all we have to do is this. Our pH is equal to our pKa, which are you okay if I just give you the pKa? pKa of acetic acid is 4.74 plus the log of our base, which comes from exactly the number of moles of our base added. That is our weak base here. And so we would put 0.0045 moles all divided by the remaining acid that we have in our scenario here, which is 0.005. Oh, did I miss a zero? Yep, good catch. Three zeros. And then apparently our 5 moles that we have there, okay? And so we take this and we say, all right, 4.74 plus log on top 0.0045 divided by 0.0005. We close that parenthesis there and we get a pH of 5.69. Okay, now this is a really convenient formula and I really like the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation. But you have to keep two things in mind. In our Henderson-Hasselbalch equation, we have to have a buffer. And a buffer, the second thing here, is going to contain at least some of the weak acid and some of its conjugate base. All right, so you have to have those two things present to be able to use that Henderson-Hasselbalch equation and throw those numbers in, okay? You have to make sure that you have that or you either have to use the ice chart in the case of weak acid, weak base, or if it's a strong acid, you have to find the molarity, plug it into the pH formula. Okay, questions? Does anybody need this? All right, so our next portions here are going to talk about titration curves, okay? So on all these titration curves, what we are going to have is this. Number one, just like we saw on the previous day of notes, the y-axis is going to be our pH. And then whatever is on bottom, it's going to be volume, but that volume of that second thing listed here. So on bottom here for this scenario, it's going to be our volume of strong base. Okay, and we want to look at the curve. Now, this is a strong acid titrated by the strong base. So the previous day notes, we actually did this, we just didn't show it in a graph. What you would get, our graph would turn out to be something like this. Remember, strong acid, it's going to have a really, really low pH, and it's not really going to change much until it hits that equivalence point, and you have this dramatic uptake in pH. Okay. At this point in time, we have crossed over and we have reached our equivalence point. Where we get that dramatic uptake, that dramatic vertical line here in our scenario. Now, something unique here. I'm going to draw a dot and talk about it here in just a second. This dot I'm drawing in pink, that dot that I drew in pink here, this is our equivalence point. Okay. Now, are you guys okay if I just call equivalence point EQ dot point? Okay, equivalence point is EQ dot point. Strong acid, strong base. Very important here. The pH at the equivalent point is exactly equal to 7. Okay, now I want to talk about how we solve for the pH throughout this problem as we add, in this case, our base. And what happens is this. On the right-hand side, essentially these are, you could think of them as steps of, hey, if I add this much acid, add this much base, I'm not quite at the equivalence point, how do I find the pH? So number one and two describes, hey, how we would do that. Now we did this in the previous day notes. Once we get past the equivalence point, remember we have extra base, and so we would actually find our pOH, and then we could subtract from 14 with that. Questions. So view this stuff on the right-hand side that you're going to write down as your steps, okay? View this as a picture of what's happening as you add drop by drop, okay? Questions, anybody need it? All right, we got four more. I'll go a little bit quicker here just because that was our initial setup, okay? Number two, we have a weak acid still titrated by a strong base. So the first thing that I want to do, again, is set up my graph. In our graph, on the left-hand side, that y-axis is going to be the pH. And we're still being titrated by a strong base. So on the bottom, it's going to be the volume of our, in this case, strong base. Now, as I change colors here, the question that I have for you guys is this. Weak acid, it's still an acid. Is it going to have a pH below 7 or above 7? Below, right? It's still an acid. Now, it's weak, so it's not going to be as low as what we saw. And we're already going to start this curved line, and it's going to kind of come up. And then we're going to hit that equivalence point again, and we're going to get something similar happen there. And eventually, that pH will level off. But again, kind of have an incline to begin. We hit the equivalence point, and we have that real dramatic uptake in pH. And so here, I want to emphasize this thing right here. And I'm going to try to estimate it as best as possible. Again, this dot in pink, we're going to consider this to be our equivalence point. and very important, and it should make sense. I got a weak acid titrated by a strong base. In this case, at the equivalence point, the pH is above 7.0, all right? That's because we got a strong base. We hit the equivalent points, and we're going to that strong base, and that's why the equivalence point pH is above 7. So questions? Anybody need this? All right, next one here, a polyprotic acid. So first off, let's start with an example of what a polyprotic acid is. Polyprotic acid, anybody remember what's unique about that? Perfect. Let's give an actual example. More than 1 Ka, which means more than 1 H that can be ionizable or given off, given away. And so let's give the example of sulfurous acid, H2SO3. Remember, sulfuric acid would be SO4. Sulfurous is that SO3. Both H2SO3 and its conjugate base HSO3 could be considered acids, and both of them could give away that H. Now, what happens here is this. We don't think about it too much, but sulfurous acid is actually a weak acid. And so it's going to start out below 7, and we're going to give that pretty decent incline, and then we're going to hit one sharp curve, and we're going to get another flattening, and it's going to come up again, and then we would finally get that last vertical intake here, okay? What this is showing us is, number one, a polyprotic acid is going to have two equivalence points, okay? I'm going to put it roughly about here and roughly about here. Again, these are all estimates here. We have no numbers to go with this. But I do want to emphasize, this, that we would call this first equivalence point. We simply refer to this as our equivalence point number one. And then we would have this second dot here, and this would be equivalence point number two. Okay. Point about this, two H's, two equivalence points, two big vertical lines when we look at our graph here. All right. Questions? Oh, I should add this, that technically in our example here, we didn't have it listed, but we should still have the pH on our vertical axis. And then because we're increasing in pH, this would be volume of our strong base that's added. Okay. Questions? Two more to go, and then we just talk about some indicators. Anybody need this? All right, so here we go. Number four, strong base titrated by a strong acid, okay? So some key differences. Number one, I'm going to start up, and I'm going to set up my graph. Again, pH is on that left-hand side vertical acid. This time, we are adding strong acid. So down here on the x-axis is going to be our volume of strong acid. Now, we start out with a strong base. So where's our pH going to start out? Is pH going to be, with a strong base, close to 14, or pH going to be close to 0? Close to 14. It's a really strong base, right? And so we would get this. Again, strong and strong is titrating. You're not going to get a whole lot of change. And then all of a sudden, you're going to get this big drop. And then the pH will eventually level off, okay? Another important point is this. Our equivalence point. I'm going to do my best here to estimate this. Our equivalence point is really unique. Again, strong titrating is strong. Our equivalence point here is going to be right here in what I would consider the center of our graph. And the pH of this equivalence point is going to be equal to exactly 7. Okay? Now, similar to how we solved the previous day's problems, we would do a very similar portion right here. We just start out with a strong base instead of a strong acid. Okay? Questions? Anybody need this? All right. Last one here. Last one that we go over here is our weak base and strong acid titration. So again, let's go ahead and let's set up our graph in that we have pH on our y-axis. And then again, strong acid is being used here. So we're going to have volume of strong acid on our x. Okay. And so I'll ask you this. It's still a base. Where is our pH going to start? Up towards the top or down on the bottom here?
Top,
close to 14, but it's still weak. And so when we think about this, number one, it's going to be a little bit lower starting point than what we previously saw. And then it is weak. So we're initially going to see a little bit steeper line. We hit that equivalence point, and then we get that big jump. Now, almost the opposite here of a previous graph. Our equivalence point here is going to be a pH below 7. Okay, so our pH here would be below 7. Okay, again, view all this info on the right-hand side as almost like a guide. We'll go over problems and do those things here. But now you kind of have a starting picture for what is happening as you add drop by drop your item that you're titrating, okay, or you're titrating, okay? Questions? Anybody need this?
Nope.
All right. Last thing is this, okay? Last thing's actually with acids and bases is our indicators. So in the lab currently, we're using phenolphthalein. The reason I picked phenolphthalein is because the equivalence point goes through the color change that we are working with, okay? So it's actually not up here. This picture here right in the middle, the one with the purple, the phenolphthalein, will be really, really similar to the lab final when I hand you that unknown concentration of acetic acid and I say, all right, go find it. Why we're using phenolphthalein again is because that big uptake in pH is going to occur at the equivalence point, and phenolphthalein, the color change from clear to that purple pink color, light pink is ideal, is gonna be right in the middle. So the point about this slide is, depending on what we're titrating, is going to determine what indicator that we need to use. There's a variety of indicators that we have, and it's all based upon where in our equivalence point, where does the pH go through, and where is that color change? There's actually a whole chart to say, hey, your pH change is going to occur this range. You should ideally use this particular indicator, all right? Questions?